Namaste. Welcome to the lecture series on the subject Applied Thermodynamics, Module 4, Part 1, Refrigeration Cycles. This is lecture number 2. Myself, Dr. N. Satish Kumar, Associate Professor of Mechanical Engineering, Canara Engineering College, Bangalore. So in the last lecture, this is lecture number 1, I introduced you to the vapor compression refrigeration cycle. So what are the basic operations or the processes involved in vapor compression refrigeration cycle? Now in this lecture, I will take you through the ideal vapor compression refrigeration cycle, then what is the actual vapor compression refrigeration cycle and its analysis. So generally, the four components of a vapor compression refrigeration cycle are evaporator, compressor, condenser and the expansion engine. But in practice, the expansion engine is not used, right? Instead, so we'll be using a expansion device called as throttling valve or capillary tube. As you know, the purpose of this expansion device is to reduce the pressure and temperature of the refrigerant. As you know, before you pass it through the evaporator coils, its temperature has to be below than that of the space to be cooled. So both temperature and pressure has to be reduced. So in a ideal vapor compression refrigeration cycle, so we use throttling valve or capillary tube, okay, not the expansion engine. The reason is the power output of the such engine is too small to justify its cost. Okay, fine. Now this is a diagram showing ideal vapor compression refrigeration cycle. As we discussed earlier, so the four components of the ideal vapor compression refrigeration cycle are the evaporator, compressor, condenser, and instead of expansion engine, now you have an expansion valve, which can be expansion valve or can be capillary tube also. Now here, the process 1 to 2, you can see here, this is the state 1 of the refrigerant, this is the state 2 of the refrigerant. So the process 1 to 2 is a compression process, wherein the refrigerant gets compressed to high pressure and temperature. So then it passes through a condenser coil. So its temperature and pressure will be higher than that of the surroundings. So therefore, the heat is rejected by the refrigerant by an amount of QH to the warm environment. Now it is passed through the expansion valve. Okay. Now here 2 to 3 is a heat rejection process, wherein it gives out the heat by an amount of QH. Then it passes through the expansion valve. So 3 to 4 is the expansion process, wherein pressure and temperature reduces and then it is made to pass through the evaporator coil to absorb the heat from the space to be cooled, all the cold refrigerated space. Now coming to the TS diagram, as all of you can see, temperature entropy diagram. So 1 to 2, so generally the compression process is isentropy compression. So in a TS diagram, isentropic compression will be a perpendicular line to the S axis, that is entropy axis. So you can see 1 to 2 is a vertical line. So here compressor requires work input. So here compressor work input is, or work is supplied or power is given to the compressor. And 2 to 3 is a condensation process. So you can see here, as all of you studied the phase diagram. So here, this part is the liquid region, this part is the liquid plus vapor region, and after this, this is a saturated vapor line, so this is the vapor region. So this is a dry saturated condition, point 1. So ideally, the vapor entering into the compressor will be dry vapor or the saturated vapor. And at the end of the compression, you can see the 0.2 is in the superheated region. So superheated vapor, when it passes through the condenser, so initially it has to be condensed or cooled back to the saturation temperature first at that pressure, and then the latent heat of evaporation is given out, and finally it will be the saturated liquid. You can see it is written saturated liquid, and point number one, it is written saturated vapor, right? So the product or end product of condensation is a saturated liquid. Okay, so 2 to 3 is a heat rejection process. Then the expansion, so it is assumed to be, actually it should have been an isentropic expansion, but it is not actually, so it is an isenthalpic expansion. So that is why 3 to 4 is 4 dash, in fact, is shown as dotted, and the actual process is shown by 3 to 4 line. So it is an isenthalpic expansion process. Now let me explain the four process in detail. Now here I'll be using the pH diagram, that is pressure versus enthalpy, here pH diagram, to explain the various process, right? So here you can see I've taken two compression process. One is 1 to 2 and is 1 dash 2 dash. 1 to 2, you can see the 0.1 is in the saturated vapor, and at the end of compression the 2.2 is in the superheated region, whereas 1 dash is in the wet region, that is wet vapor, and at the end of compression it is in the dry vapor region or the saturated vapor region. So let me go through the difference between these two. So process 1 to 2 or 1 dash 2 dash, both are the isentropic compression or the reversible adiabatic compression process. So process 1 to 2 starts at saturated vapor. As I told you earlier, this point is a saturated vapor, you can see here, and it ends in the superheated region, that is point number 2 here, and that is called as dry compression process, because here the dry vapor is compressed. Whereas 1 dash 2 dash, so point 1 starts from wet region, here you can see this is a wet region here, right, and it ends in the dry vapor state or saturated vapor at 2 dash, and it is called as wet compression. So usually dry compression is always preferred over the wet compression. And coming to the process 2 to 3 or 2 dash 3, which is nothing but reversible constant pressure heat rejection process. So here 2 to 3 or 2 dash 2 3 is a constant pressure process, wherein the working substance, which is passing through the condenser coil at high pressure and temperature, gives out heat to the surrounding atmosphere. Now here the point to be noted is here is 2 is in the superheated region. So whenever the vapor passing through the condenser coil is in the superheated state, so initially its temperature has to be reduced to the saturated temperature at 2 dash. So 2 to 2 dash is called as de-superheating. De-superheating means 2 to 2 dash, it will be still in vapor state. Only thing is its temperature reduces from the superheated point to the saturation point. And once it reaches the saturation point at 2 dash, further 2 to 3 is the condensation, where purely the latent heat of evaporation is given out. Okay, so the amount of heat removed is nothing but the latent heat. Now at the end of the point 3, that is end of the condensation, you can see the state of the refrigerant is a saturated liquid. You can see the point 3 on the saturated liquid line. Now process 3 to 4 is the adiabatic throttling process, for which enthalpy before is equal to the enthalpy after throttling. So this is an isenthalpic process. So this process is adiabatic but not isentropic, though there is no heat transfer, because adiabatic is a process wherein there is no heat transfer. So here also there is no heat transfer, but doesn't mean that entropy remains same. Okay, since it is reversible, it cannot be shown on a property diagram. So states 3 and 4 are equilibrium points, are simply joined by a dotted line following a constant enthalpy line. So 3 to 4, the dotted line is overwritten by the continuous line of the isenthalpic line from 3 to 4. And process 4 to 1 is a reversible constant pressure process wherein the refrigerant at low temperature, the temperature well below the space to be cooled, absorbs heat from the space, right, and then evaporates. So that is why the name evaporator. So here refrigerant enters at a temperature below that of the space to be cooled, absorbs heat from the compartment or the space, and it gets evaporated. So thereby the space to be cooled, or which is also called as the surrounding or space to be cooled, gets refrigerated. Refrigerated in the sense it is maintained at temperature below than that of the surroundings. So thus evaporator thus produces the cooling or refrigerating effect. So actual cooling is taking place in the evaporator. So that you have to understand. Now let us analyze this ideal vapor compression cycle. So the compressor, condenser and evaporator are treated as steady flow devices. As you know, a steady flow device is governed by steady flow energy equation. So all of you studied this in the first law of thermodynamics, in the subject basic thermodynamics. Now we have to apply this steady flow energy equation to these devices, and you have to find out what is the expression for work input to the compressor, what is the expression for the heat removed by the condenser, and what is the expression for the heat absorbed by the evaporator. Now let us take the compressor first. So 1 to 2 is the isentropic compression. So for isentropic process, there is no heat transfer. So Q1 to 2 is equal to 0. So you know that Q minus W is equal to delta H. So there is a steady flow energy equation. Q minus W, actually it is equal to delta H plus delta KE plus delta PE. But here delta KE, that is change in kinetic energy, and change in potential energy are neglected. So delta KE and delta KE are 0, P are 0. So Q minus W is equal to delta H. But for compressor, the process is isentropic. Q1 to 2 is also 0. So this term is also 0. So it becomes W1 to 2 is becomes minus delta H, because this minus goes to the other side. Now delta H is nothing but H2 minus H1, or compressor work is nothing but H2 minus H1. Now you can think what happened to this minus sign when it comes to here. Because when I write compressor work, so compressor work will be always the negative work. So no need to write the negative sign, since just you write H2 minus H1. But while calculating, you can use minus of H2 minus H1 as if you write the expression as W1 to 2. Suppose if you write the expression as work of compression, directly you can write it as H2 minus H1, because this quantity, though numerically it is positive, because it is a negative work, because it is a compressor work. And the unit of this work is kilojoules per kg, that is on unit mass basis. Now suppose if you know the mass flow rate of the refrigerant, or if it is given as MR in kg per second, so then you are supposed to find out the power input to the compressor. You see, you should know what is the compressor work input. Also, you should know the mass flow rate of the refrigerant. Then power input to the compressor is given by MR into H2 minus H1 in kilowatt. Now coming to the condenser, so the process 2 to 3 is the condensation process, which is nothing but the reversible constant pressure heat rejection. So constant pressure heat rejection, since it is a constant pressure process, as all of you know, the work transfer here is zero. There is no work input or there is no work output as well. So what happens? Q minus W is equal to delta H, W is equal to 0. So it becomes Q2 to 3 is equal to delta H. So delta H for the process 2 to 3 is nothing but the final enthalpy minus initial enthalpy. It is H3 minus H2. So here H3 is less than H2 because there is heat rejection. So initial enthalpy is more, final enthalpy is less. So this is always a negative quantity, indicating that heat is rejected. Now heat rejected per unit mass of the refrigerant, that is in kilojoules per kg, is always given by Q1 or QH. You see, both you can use it as Q1 or QH, like you can use the temperature of the high temperature reservoir as TH or T1. Here also you can represent it as Q1 or QH. So it is given by H2 minus H. Since I am using the word heat rejected, so when I use the word heat rejected, so this answer has to be always positive. So you should not do H3 minus H2. You should do it H2 minus H3, because you should get a positive answer because already you used the word rejected. Okay. Now direct calculation, always H3 minus H2. You get negative answer, which is indicating that heat is rejected. So here I am not writing heat rejected. I am just writing this is negative. So therefore heat rejected. So rate of heat rejection is nothing but MR into H2 minus H3 in kilojoules per second. So you have to multiply the H2 minus H3 by mass flow rate of the refrigerant. Now coming to the evaporator. So process 4 to 1. So reversible constant pressure process. So once again W 4 to 1 is 0 because it is a constant pressure process. So Q 4 to 1 becomes delta H. So delta H for the process 4 to 1 is nothing but final enthalpy minus initial enthalpy, which is nothing but H1 minus H4. Okay. So H1 minus H4. So H1 is higher here. H4 is less because when it enter the refrigerant enters the evaporator coil, its enthalpy is less. But after absorbing heat from the space to be cooled, its enthalpy is higher. So H1 is higher, H4 is less. So H1 minus H4 is a positive quantity. So heat received, this is the heat received by unit mass of the refrigerant. Okay. So you can write as Q2. As I told you earlier, you can use the symbol QL also for the amount of heat absorbed by the refrigerant from the space to be cooled or from the substance. So Q2 you can write as H1 minus H4, or you can write as QL is equal to H1 minus H4. This is on unit mass basis in kilojoules per kg. Suppose if you want the rate of heat removal, which is nothing but refrigerating effect. So it should be written as Q2 dot. Okay, here on dot you can put, you can write as Q2 dot. So Q2 dot is equal to MR into H1 minus H4. Because why I put dot? Because it is the rate of heat removal, Q2 dot. Okay, it will be in kilojoules per second, right? Or as I told earlier, you can use the symbol QL also. So this is MR into H1 minus H4, where MR is nothing but the mass flow rate of the refrigerant. Suppose if you want to calculate the refrigerating effect in terms of refrigeration, then this MR into H1 minus H4, that is the Q2 dot for the refrigerating effect, has to be divided by 3.5, because 1 ton is equal to 3.5 kilojoules per second. So MR into H1 minus H4 is the amount of heat received or absorbed by the refrigerant in kilojoules per second. If you divide by 3.5, you will get the answer refrigerating effect in terms of refrigeration. Okay. Now coming to the last device, that is the expansion device. Process 3 to 4 is the expansion. So here H3 is equal to H4 because it is isenthalpic process. So values of enthalpy, that is H1, H2, H3 and H4, can be obtained from the property tables or the property charts or diagrams. So that I'll explain how to note down these readings using table or the chart when I take up the numericals, when I solve the numericals. So with this I conclude the lecture number 2 and will continue the topic in lecture number 3. Thank you.